So thank you for inviting me and my wife to speak. I also thank Dr. Nalli Chandran for introducing me to your group. I see that Bumsy is also there. He had worked with us for some time. So I'm going to talk to you about our experience at this hospital. It is not a Bible study, but a sharing of God's faithfulness to us in the last 27 years. So this is the Barak River, which passes through our district. We are part of the Barak Valley of Assam. And Assam is a very thickly forested area with heavy rainfall. So this is one of our ponds inside the hospital campus. So you can see two dots in that map. So my wife and me are from Tamil Nadu. I was from Chennai and my wife was from Madurai. And we moved to this hospital, Makunda Krishnan Hospital, in 1993. So it is a journey of faith. So we trust God to lead us by our hands and take us to the right place and be with us, be the source of all wisdom and strength and encouragement. So why did we go there? So I think all of you will know this passage from the Bible. It says, I know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. But we don't often read the next two verses. So to me, when I was in college, I was not sure what God wanted me to do. And this verse spoke to me. I understood that when I submit everything into God's hands and understand that He has excellent purposes and plans for me, only then will I call upon Him and only then will He listen to me and answer me, because God looks at the thoughts of our hearts and not just the words of our mouth. So I soon realized that many parts of India are not like Tamil Nadu. And for you, I can say that many parts of India are not like Andhra Pradesh or Telangana, because those places are really deprived. People have to get good medical care. So God wanted me to go to a place where there is great need. So I made a simple formula. The potential for transformational impact by one person is equal to the total population in that particular place divided by the total number of other people who have the same training. So at that time in Northeast India, there was a very thickly populated area here in Assam, but with hardly any other doctors who are trained like us. So that is my motivation to move to this place, to be in a place where the greatest transformation can come through our life. And this is my wife Anne's verse. So she had gone to a meeting where people were talking about the needs of North India and asking, is there anyone in this group who is willing to say, I am willing to go? So both of us were motivated to go and serve in a remote rural location. And that is how we searched for what is the best place. And through various circumstances, we were led to join this hospital. So this is Makunda. In 1950, it was started as a leprosy colony. And then a senior doctor, a consultant from USA joined this hospital. And it was a general hospital also. But in the 1980s, the hospital was closed because the government asked all the foreign staff to leave. And for 10 years, it was closed. So this was the hospital when we visited in 1992. A lot of empty buildings, no outpatients, and only a few leprosy patients inside the hospital. And but soon, at that time, I had done my MS in general surgery, and my wife had done only her MBBS. She waited for 7 years to go and do her post-graduation. So because we were able to do surgeries, soon it became quite busy. And we had a lot of problems in the hospital because there were no patients, there was no money, and there were a lot of rebellious employees who wanted to see the hospital closed. But at the same time, it was a great opportunity because there was no other hospital in this large area, and we had a very large forested land. So at that time, the management wanted to hand over this hospital to Emmanuel Hospital Association in New Delhi. And when we spoke to them, they said that we are not very confident of taking over this hospital unless you are willing to give a long-term commitment. So when we asked, how long do you want us to work there? They said, till your retirement. So that was a 30-year period. So after we joined, we made a plan for the next 10 years, and then for the next 10 years, and then for the last 10 years. So that was possible because we had made a 30-year commitment, and we have now completed 27 of those years. The early years were very difficult. There was no water and electricity. And in our homes also, there was no water and electricity. And that conditions continued for nearly 14 years. Oxygen was not available. It has to be bought from very far away. So we had to be very careful in the use of resources. That is my wife with my daughter on her back. And that baby was a patient who had a tracheoesophageal fistula repair. So all these babies had to be ventilated by hand because we didn't have a ventilator. And my wife did that for 4 days for all these babies. But little by little, the hospital improved. We were able to buy new equipment. And in 2018-19, we saw 100,000 outpatients, 14,000 inpatients, 3,000 major surgeries, 6,000 deliveries. And this year, it is even more than that. That is because a lot of poor people in that area started to come in large numbers. This is our new labor room and our NICU. In 2004, we started an English medium school because local people did not have a good quality school, and our staff also did not have a good school to send their children. So now, 16 years later, this school has 1,200 children up to class 12 in arts and science. In 2006, we started a school of nursing because we found that many places in Northeast did not have enough population to sustain a hospital. So we thought in those places, nurses can provide medical care. And today, this nursing school is being upgraded to a college of nursing. And in 2005, we started a branch hospital in the state of Tripura. It was the only Christian hospital in that state at that time. At the time, there was a lot of militancy, and people could not work because of fear. And we were the only hospital in that place. And now that is being upgraded also. And I started doing a lot of biodiversity documentation. So these are some photographs I've taken. So we soon realized that most of the patients who come to our hospital are very poor. And this is a lady who had a 35 kilogram ovarian tumor. I don't think you will see a patient like this in your area because they would easily go to a government hospital and they will get free treatment. But this lady could not go anywhere because they were too poor to get treatment in a private hospital. So they would have had to sell their land and their land, house to get treated. So slowly this lady had a very large mass, and the family decided that it is better to let her die so that the husband can marry another woman instead of wasting all their property on her treatment. So that is how very poor people think. So we were able to operate on her and remove that tumor, but she probably died because it was ovarian cancer. So people, when they are poor, they come very late for treatment. They just hope that they will get better. They don't go to a doctor, and often they come too late to be healed. And they don't have much money in their hand, so they come with whatever money they have got. So this lady has brought 4 eggs for her treatment. So last year, a group of students from this Wharton School of Business visited our hospital, and they did an impact assessment of the work at Makunda over the previous 25 years. So this is their report. So these are certain innovations we have done to make sure that poor people get treated. We have our own protocol for finding out who is financially vulnerable, and we provide them charity depending upon that. The charity is given even before they ask for free treatment, because very large number of poor people will not ask. They will simply go and sell their important assets. And we also do not have private rooms in our hospital. We do not have private consultation. The same treatment is provided to everybody. So that is to make sure that the poor people feel comfortable in our hospital. So they should not think that they are second-class citizens. And some investigations are not available in our hospital. So we don't have a CT scan or nuclear scans. So we have changed gold standard protocols to ensure that treatment can be provided with what we have. So if you are interested, you can have a look at this article, which is on the internet. So it was recently published. So this is the article published by the chief investigator of this study, along with Anne and me giving some internal insights. So these are some of the points I had already told you. So sometimes people come having already sold their home or their land, and we try to get back that land and give it back to those poor people. So all the staff and students are oriented to poverty and to think of how to live and to work very simply so that poor people can get the maximum benefit. So you may think that if you do all these things that the hospital will close, but actually as volumes increase and as bed occupancy increases, more and more poor people can get treatment, and the hospital actually does very well financially. And it has an impact on the maternal mortality rate and infant mortality rate, because these people, they are the people who are excluded. They don't go to hospital. And they, once they start coming to hospital, then their lives can be saved. So obviously, we are not the only people in the district who are providing these services. But in those years when the numbers of our deliveries increased, the maternal mortality and infant mortality in our district also decreased. And we provide targeted services at fixed cost, like ICU is 500 rupees per day. So that is made possible by subsidizing the treatment in ICU, taking into account income from other departments where there is a higher margin, like ultrasound. So our hospital does about 18,000 ultrasounds in a year, and the excess income from there goes to subsidize ICU treatment. So if you look at that screen, we have received a lot of money, but out of that, 3 crore has been given as charity to poor people, and we still have some excess for development of the hospital. So this is to say that if you have a focus on poor people, it does not mean the hospital is going to struggle. It can still do well. So we have also developed partnerships with a lot of institutions, many of them from outside India. And we have received the entry level accreditation to NABH in 2018, and this year it has again been renewed for another 2 years. So although the hospital is focused on the poor, it is able to provide high quality services. The quality has been inspected and accredited by an external body. In 2016, my wife and I were given this Paul Harrison Award by CMC Vellore. It is given for lifetime achievement for alumni. But we think that we should work for an even greater reward, which only God can give. And that is to say, well done, good and faithful servant, when we die and go to be with him in heaven. And that is should be all our ambition. All of us should aspire for that reward. So these are some of the work done by our nature club. It documented a lot of local flora and fauna, and a lot of research and publications. These are some of my photographs. So this is what we want to ask you all. Are you willing to take this less traveled road? I'm sure very few people in Andhra Pradesh and Telangana will want to leave their homes and their home states to go to another area of great need. Many people go to foreign countries like the USA or the UK, but very few go to foreign countries where there is great need, like in Africa. So are we willing to think like that? So we want to acknowledge God and a lot of large numbers of staff who have worked with us. So these are some research projects which are still going on. This is our nursing school students and our school students. So, in the last 5 years, we have this partnership with the Royal Dutch Tropical Institute in the Netherlands, and 4 of their residents, postgraduate students, in doing their MD in Global Health and Tropical Medicine, they come and work in our hospital for 6 months and get experience. And after that, many of them go and work in very remote places in other countries like Ethiopia, South Sudan, and places like that. We are also helping other people to start new services in difficult places. And we are also writing about how to make good plans and models. So this is our present focus, our third phase of Mukunda strategic plan. These are one batch of students who have come from the Netherlands. And now at the end of 27 years, we have handed over to the next set of leaders. This is Dr. Roshin, who has taken over from me as the medical superintendent and CEO. So we need to hand over to younger leaders and to stay with them so that they can become confident and comfortable. So we will be here for a few more years till we retire. That is our two daughters. These are some of our staff. I just wanted to show you some of the medical work at our hospital. This is a small child who had a piece of jewelry inside her lungs. So we were able to remove that with a rigid bronchoscope. There are a lot of babies who came with tracheoesophageal fistula. That is the thoracotomy. At present in our hospital, we have a baby who has been operated and is now doing well. There's another baby who had a diaphragmatic hernia. So all the bowel is inside their chest and we have closed it. This is a young lady who had a large tumor inside her chest and she came with a massive hemoptysis. So this is my wife giving anesthesia. That is a middle lobe of the lung, right lung, which was removed. She had a teratoma in her lungs. This is a boy who had a neurogenic bladder and we have done a Mitrofenov operation. This is a boy who had a ambiguous genitalia and we have done a masculinizing genitoplasty. Now it has become like a normal male genitalia. So Northeast India has a lot of choledochal cysts and we have one of those which has been removed. So this is an article which I did when I was in doing my MCH in CMC Vellore, an operation called pneumonostomy for hydrated cysts of the lung. And this is now the gold standard for this condition. It's being done all over the world. Another innovation we did in Vellore to treat babies with gastroschisis using plastic material from a urine drainage bag. And this is one of 8 articles we have published on biodiversity. There's a lot of wildlife around our hospital. This is a chapter I have written in a Dutch book on global health. This is the first article published from Makunda and it is about thiamine deficiency. So in our hospital we see mothers who come with paralysis of the limbs, lower limbs, and in heart failure. We also have infants who come with cardiac beriberi. So we have studied all of this and Dr. Roshin has presented it in a conference in Laos, organized by the New York Academy of Sciences, and a lot of research is going on thiamine deficiency. So I wanted to show you all those pictures just to say that because we go to a remote rural place, it doesn't mean we cannot be professionally excellent. So actually there is even more scope to be professionally excellent and do research which will have a long lasting impact in low resource hospitals across the world. So these are some things I want to tell you from what we have learned. The first thing is that many of us go to places of need but do not want to stay very long. We want to work for 6 months or 1 year or 2 years. But very often the major changes, major transformation occurs only when we wait for many years. They don't happen in short periods. So are we willing to make that long-term commitment? This is a lesson from successful mission enterprises all across the world. Major changes take time. Often a whole career or a lifetime spent in an area of need. And very often we get disillusioned when things don't change immediately. So some things can be changed and we should try and change those things. But some things cannot be changed and we should learn to live with those issues. The severe local problems in Mukunda were managed by God's grace. We had a lot of problems from local people, court cases filed against us, and sickness. I had a heart attack and then I had leprosy. And we had struggled for many years without finances. But in spite of all those problems, today Mukunda is thriving and is doing really well. It is a lesson to all mission hospitals in our country that no institution is beyond redemption, and by God's grace, they can all be revived. And you may think that nobody will want to go and work in a hospital like that, where there is no electricity and water and so much of difficulty. And it was like that in the beginning. When somebody was asked to come and work at Mukunda, they will ask, what wrong have I done? Why should I go to a place like that? But today, people from all over India and some from abroad also have come and are working here. That is again God's grace. So we started many services and they were accepted by our target population. The target population is the poor population of this area. So how can we do that? How can we get excluded people to become included? So God will give us wisdom. So we also got into partnership with the local government. They included us in all their programs. And now they are also supporting us with various projects. A new road is being constructed. New buildings are being constructed by funds given by the government. So very often we don't want to partner with the government. But here the government itself has come and sought our partnership. So mission hospitals are important because they are built and they have been founded to serve excluded populations. Maybe they need to reinvent themselves. So I was in Vizianagaram some year, 2 years ago, and visited a mission hospital, and I was just thinking, why is a mission hospital needed in this place when government services are so excellent? Everything is free, CT scan and MRI and everything is available close by. But as I was talking to them, I realized there were a lot of migrants. People who have come from Jharkhand and Bihar and UP, and they were providing all the construction work. And they do not get services because they don't have a local health card. So there will always be excluded populations. And if we can provide services for them, then that will be a great blessing. And many of our mission hospitals today are sick because of changes. They are not adapted to those changes. They have lost core values. But they can all be rectified. Just like we are able to diagnose and treat sicknesses in human people, we can also do the same for our mission hospitals. So these are some things that I want to leave with you. God has good plans for us, plans to prosper us and not to harm us. When we have understood this, we will go and ask Him, what do you want me to do with my life? And He will answer us because we really want to do something that is pleasing in God's sight. But very often we are afraid of God's will. We are afraid that someone else will control our life. We are afraid that we will miss out on all the pleasures of this world. But I would like to suggest that this is the best possible investment of our life, because our treasure should be in heaven. And only what we do for God will earn us treasure in heaven. So we must live our lives by seeking and finding what is pleasing in God's sight. And in this world, we will be given peace and contentment and eternal riches in heaven. The Bible says that being a living sacrifice is a reasonable act of worship. To put all our talents and our time and all our material possessions in this world into God's hands, that is a reasonable act of worship. Very often when we say worship, we think about singing. The singing doesn't cost us anything, but actual worship is to surrender our lives into God's hands. We should also live with a heavenly perspective. So we are not citizens of this world. We are just citizens of the kingdom of heaven, temporarily posted to this world. So we should not put in deep roots here. Our intentions and our plans and purposes should be as citizens of God's kingdom. The values of this world are temporary. We should not live for those values, for riches and achievements, but instead we should live for heavenly values. So we all will go through some sort of difficulties, because no one is going to have a comfortable and pleasant life. And when we go and work in difficult places, there will always be some problem there. But we should not make those into big issues. Otherwise, we will become like martyrs and become useless. Instead, we should look at our difficulties and problems as trivial temporary inconveniences. And that is what they are compared to the riches we will have in heaven. So prayer and Bible study are very important, and we should do all that, especially in our student years. We should also go and be part of a good fellowship. But these do not replace trust and obedience. They should go along with trust and obedience. We should trust God so that He will take us by our hands and lead us in the way that He wants us to go. And we should obey every small instruction. Only then will our life be of great value. So we should make a vow. I will live for God's approval. Everything I think and plan and do should be pleasing in His sight. So the knowledge that God is approving of what I want to do, that is enough. Other things don't matter. The work that He has entrusted me to do should take top priority. It should be the reason for the choices we make. And we should be willing to die for God. But die means not to die as a physical death, but to our own ambitions and our own wishes. Only then can God use us powerfully for Him. All of you are students. We must excel in our studies. Sometimes we might learn something in medical college just to pass the exams. But sometimes something that you have learned will make a life and death difference to a patient far away. You never know which piece of information is important. So we should study hard and make the best use of all the opportunities before us. So I was quite good in my studies, and I developed a system of study which I have written it on the internet. So if you are interested, you can have a look at it on my blog. So I'm sure that many of you are thinking about your post-graduation. Maybe some of you are already post-graduates. But I would like to suggest that post-graduation should be our slave and not our master. I took a break of 3 years after my MBBS just to be very clear about where God wants me to go and to equip myself to be a confident doctor, because I felt that what I learned during internship was not enough. So I worked for in a mission hospital in Tamil Nadu for 3 years at Ottanjathiram. So I suggest that all of you spend at least a year after MBBS to go out and see the world and ask God to speak to you and to teach you how to be a good doctor. So there are many mission hospitals where you can spend a year or two. In our hospital also, we can take people who have a missionary interest. So we should do the course that fits into the work. So my interest in medical college was in medicine. I like to make diagnosis. And I wanted to be a cardiologist because they were some of the best doctors in our medical college. But when I joined this mission hospital in Tamil Nadu and heard people returning from mission fields and talking about their experiences, I realized that being a cardiologist would not be very useful in a place where people don't have money and the hospital is not well equipped. So I decided to do surgery. I thought I can use my theoretical knowledge to manage medical patients, but I needed to learn skills to be a surgeon. But suppose I was going to join a hospital which already has a surgeon, maybe I should do some other specialty. And then later on I did pediatric surgery because there was no pediatric surgeon in the entire southern half of Northeast India. So there were 5 states where there were no pediatric surgeons. So I did that specialty because there was no one else to whom we could refer these patients. And I also want to talk to you about marriage. So very often people get into emotional decisions in medical college. But emotions cloud our mind. We are not able to think rationally and we don't use logic, and we can make some rash decisions. And very often all missionary plans are lost by making the wrong choice. So we should rather think logically and ask God to lead us to the right person who will fill in our gaps and help us to do His will. So how can we find out about a person? What is going on in his or her mind? So very often we judge people on their external appearances, on their achievements, and the way they present themselves. But if you look at the decisions they make and the way they what is important in their lives, it is easy to find out what is the driving force. So we should look at the inner being of a person. And it is also good to wait to make that decision, because first we need to know where God wants us to go. Then we can make other decisions based upon that. A good marriage will ensure that two people can help and encourage each other. So in Makunda, I'm sure that we would not have survived so far if both of us had not been totally committed to a place like this. Some people may decide to remain unmarried. If you look at missionary history in India, especially if you look at medical missionary history, even in Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, a lot of it was done by unmarried women. So they chose to be unmarried because they could not find boys with a similar vision. So it is neither a weakness or a disgrace, and it is God's portion for some of his children. Parents have a role in our lives. They are the ones who support us, provide for all our needs as children. And some of them happily send their children away to mission fields, but sometimes they don't. And they don't because they fear that their children will be in danger or they may lose out on life. So we need to prepare them, and it may take some time for them to understand. So we need, as far as possible, to let them support. But sometimes they may not support till the end, and we may have to go against their wishes to join mission hospitals. And God will guide us and provide us the strength to do that. We should also be conscious of the passage of time. Recently, a doctor who joined us as a junior doctor suddenly became sick. She had cancer, and then she died at a young age. So we do not know how long we are going to live in this world. Time is very short. In 2008, I had a heart attack, and streptokinase was not available in our hospital. I was taken to Vellore after 10 days, and stenting was done. But my ejection fraction is only 35%. But I could have easily died on that day. So we should use the opportunities that are given to us, because we do not know how much longer we will be allowed to live in this world. And every day that opportunity will decrease. We should not get distracted. There are so many things that will tempt us. So many things that look very appealing. The quickest and the shortest path in fulfilling God's instructions in our life is the path that we should take. So today I would suggest that all of you take stock of your life. Where are you? Where are you going? Is that the place where God wants you to go? Does God want you to go somewhere else? Do you need to make some course correction in your life? So let us stop for a moment and think and ask God to give us the strength and the wisdom and the encouragement to take the path that He wants us to go. So we need to learn to trust God for everything. He is not saying, just go and work in this place. He's saying, I will come with you. Hold my hand. I will take you in my hand. And let us go together. And let us work in this place where there is a great need. Sometimes everything looks very difficult. The home situation is very difficult. Or the work situation is very difficult. But God, with God, nothing is impossible. He will ensure success. Sometimes that success may not happen during our period. But every work is like a railway line, as a piece of rail, and we work on that piece of rail. And then it is time to hand over to somebody else. So sometimes the great changes happen later on. In our case, we are privileged that we were able to see great changes happen in our lifetime. But our obedience is what is important, and not the fruit that is up to God. We should also learn to see through eyes of faith. Sometimes we see with our own physical eyes and we think that all this is foolishness. But God never instructs His people unless He has a very clear and beautiful purpose in mind. So we should simply move forward in faith. We must commune with our commanding officer. Commune means we must develop a God consciousness. Not pray to God once in the morning, but constantly think, what would God do if he was in my place? And have him live in our life. Sometimes we are weak, but God's strength is made perfect in our weakness. There are more than 1,000 hospitals, mission hospitals in India in 1947. More than 50% of them have closed. So many of these hospitals need to be restarted. And some new ones also must be started in places where there is no hospital. So are we willing to go and be God's agents of change? We need to close the gap. So every year, billions of dollars are spent across the world providing the same medical care, better medical care to the same people. And year after year, a group of people are excluded. They die of easily treatable diseases in the prime of their youth. So that gap must be closed. Are we willing to help God to close that gap, to be instruments in his hands? So that is the challenge before all of us. Are we willing to say, here I am, send me? Are we willing to be God's plan, part of God's plan for excluded people in our country? So I think maybe there are some of you to whom God is speaking. And maybe some of you have made a silent prayer, a promise to serve God.